how do you go beyond traveling in zero time? Well, that's when
traveling
you get
in negative
the ability
time
to arrive before you even leave. In other words, traveling in a negative amount of time, otherwise known as immeasurable speed, or the ability to move and or travel any length of distance in a negative amount of time. The reason we call it immeasurable is mainly due to how negative spells the speed equation. When you introduce negative numbers, let's say for instance, essentially would mean that time is undefined, because literally traveling anywhere in negative seconds is practically impossible to calculate mathematically. Therefore, the speed cannot be measured, hence the name immeasurable speed. Now, although I do believe this definition still works, however, it was mainly put out there for consistency's sake. And there are many other ways to help better describe and or classify characters for having this level of speed. Let's go over that. Immeasurable speed, in a literal sense, is time traveling via sheer speed alone. As in, they're running so fast that they can travel either backwards or forwards.
The Minutemen dudes.
They literally have the
ability. Damn, that's crazy. Disney scale.
Time, or better yet, they can move and or travel throughout all of time. But to make it clear again, this is only due to their speed. Abilities do not count.
Damn.
As characters who travel throughout time via teleportation or portals, sometimes get confused for having immeasurable speed. So now we've covered traveling infinite distances, moving in zero time and or no time at all, and even traveling beyond time itself. But what can possibly be above all of time with nothing holding you back? Well, it's time to talk about the speed tier. It is literally named after the idea of the very concept of speed itself being considered irrelevant. Speed so fast that both sides of the speed equation don't even apply to the character's movement.
You fucked.
Which entails that you are qualitatively beyond both the concept of distance and the concept of time. The speed, which is defined as moving and or traveling so fast that a character's movement translates the very concept of speed itself. But if you look at the definition for relevant speed, is basically referred to as the speed for only outer personal characters, which are basically beings that transcend both the concept of time and space, which also entails that they transcend the concept of dimensions. Now, while it is true that outer personal beings most often have irrelevant speed, it is not true that an outer personal character inherently has irrelevant speed, nor is it untrue that a character who is not outer personal can have irrelevant speed as well. Reasoning for this is that it is possible for a non-outerversal character to have speed that is transcendent of the concept of speed, while simultaneously this same character in of themselves does not transcend the concepts of space or dimensions. And this is also applicable to outerversal characters as well, because there could be an outerversal character that is transcendent of space, but also lacks speed that is transcendent of the concept of speed. For example, the Flash from DC to the source, which has a low end, is more than an outerversal distance away from the local multiverse, is an example of a character having a relevant speed without being outerversal. And a character is destroying an outerversal sized realm, but has not demonstrated speed feats of any kind, and that'd be an example of an outerversal character that doesn't have a relevant speed. However, I do want to point out that these kinds of instances are not only incredibly rare, but it's also pretty.
Yeah, he literally the, when you talk about speed, he that nigga, bro, like, he that guy.
Sometimes decide to not even touch power scaling because trying to defend characters that are just coincidentally that weird is just a lot.
And then Flash would just take your speed, bro.
Characters don't have a relevant speed would have to be mobile to make any kind of sense. Mobile, also known as the speed equivalent to a tree, which is nuts. But wait a minute, where is omnipresence? Shouldn't that be the highest speed tier? This is such a huge misconception, but I understand where the confusion comes from. Let's start off by defining omnipresence. It's the property to be present everywhere and anywhere at the same time. Or less broadly, the state of being widespread and constantly encountered. This may sound impressive on the surface, but let's extrapolate the definition and give a few examples why it isn't. Technically, I consider omnipresent throughout the entire universe. As you are literally the universe and everything in it, you would feel everything that's going on, and as the definition goes, you are literally everywhere at once. What I'm getting at is that omnipresence, or being omnipresent, is not a speed. It is, as defined, a state of being, which relates to the physical condition of a person, meaning you experience it all the time. It's by definition a part of your physical self. Being only refers to a character's ability to move and operate. For example, humans and cats have the ability to move on their own because their state of being allows them to, while trees, for instance, don't have the ability to move on their own because their state of being literally prevents them from doing so. If you think about it, being considered omnipresent would be more detrimental than if anything. Because if we go back to you embodying a universe and say, I'm inside you, I can literally attack you anywhere and everywhere and hit you every single time. Because again, you are omnipresent throughout the entire universe. You cannot dodge me if you are physically everywhere and anywhere at once. There is also a common misconception surrounding omnipresence, specifically the idea, if a character is omnipresent, say, for example, throughout a universe, that they would be omnipresent everywhere else. Omnipresence, in all cases, does not embody the entirety of existence, and can be limited to certain spaces. A famous example of this is one of the primary villains from Spawn, Malvolgia, who is omnipresent throughout his own realm, but nowhere else. Well, anyway, that's it for the video. This video was a lot longer than expected, but I hope that
pretty nice.
And helped you learn more about all the different spaces.
He a goat, bro. It's alright. He'll bounce back. They took that exactly from Dragon Ball Super.
Hello everyone, and welcome back to another episode of Power Scaling 101. I'm your host, Surfbone. And today, we'll be learning about how to scale and mirror your strength. Because although it may sound simple enough on its own, which it kind of is, however, we'll be mainly going over the different technical terms that are important when specifying the strength of a character and how to implement that into power scaling. When it comes to scaling a strength of a character, there are two different classifications you need to be aware of, these two being attack potency and destructive capacity. To make things very easy and simple to understand, essentially, AP refers to who you can hurt, and DC refers to what you can destroy. For example, if a character can damage, harm, or even kill a character that can destroy the Earth, that character would then classify as having planetary levels of AP, or, more simply, planetary AP. But you may be asking, why would you assume first this character is simply class canon because he was only stated to be capable of destroying a planet? Unless specified otherwise, this should never be your first assumption, because it's way more logical to believe that if the character wouldn't be able to withstand the force at least comparable to their own attacks, their body would immediately break apart with an automatic counterforce whenever they try to exert themselves. Essentially, you would always assume first that a character should be able to tank whatever they can dish out, which comes from Newton's third law of motion, that for every action there's an equal and opposite reaction, as the two forces, action force and reaction force, are always paired, and there is never just one force. For destructive capacity, or DC, in more technical terms, refers the amount of energy a character can reduce, and is usually measured in units of energy. For example, if a character destroys a planet via a punch or energy blast, then they would be classified as having planetary levels of DC, or planetary DC. So all of that's pretty simple to understand, hopefully. Let's get into what you need to take into consideration when talking about a character's AP and DC, such as, a character's DC would always scale to their AP, but it's not always the same about giving the heroes a reason to hold back sometimes, because they're afraid of what more damage they can cause as a result. Now that we've covered the importance of a character's AP and DC, there are two other types of strength related to power scaling that I've yet to bring up, that being striking strength and lifting strength. And today with me, I brought my good friend Noodles to help with this section, as he can give us a much more detailed explanation of these two categories.
The differences between not only striking and lifting strength, but also attack potency and how strength can correlate and not correlate to it. So to begin, we must define exactly what strength is. To give you the common definition from Google, strength, or strong in this case, is defined as having the power to move heavy weights or perform other physically demanding tasks. The common perception of a strong individual is someone who is muscular or someone who is capable of performing physically demanding tasks, such as weightlifting, as referenced in the definition itself. But this is not actually enough to define what strength truly is in regards to power
strength.
So to be more specific, strength is the capability to engage muscle motor neurons and the muscle fibers attached to generate the force necessary to achieve a specific outcome. The motor neurons and their muscle fibers are referred to as a motor unit. Force is a mass times its acceleration. So depending on how much of a mass is there and how fast said mass is accelerating, we'll decide how much force is outputted from these motor units. There are multiple ways someone could be considered strong. A powerlifter is viewed as strong much in the same way that a sprinter's legs are seen as strong, yet these two have developed completely different strengths for a different task. Strength training is achieved by completing very specific tasks in order to achieve very specific outcomes. For example, if you want to become good at lifting objects with your arms above your head whilst laying on the ground, bench press allows you to train those muscles to do that. If you want to run a 100-meter dash in 9.58 seconds, practicing sprints and short distances will help you achieve that goal as well. Lifting strength is a very broad category that refers to any strength task related to lifting and generally to how much it takes to lift. To put this in an example,
do you live, bro?
That is lifting strength.
So based on the average weight of a car, we can assume Superman has a lifting strength of 2,874 pounds. Simple enough. Now, striking strength ties into this as well, because the strongest strikers on the planet tend to be boxing, MMA, and other martial arts competitors. Obviously, a boxer will be able to hit significantly harder than a powerlifter, for much the same as a powerlifter can squat more than a sprinter. The muscles being trained within their bodies are specifically designed to perform a certain task, and boxers train their arms and body to perform the task of striking, so they tend to hold the capability of generating much more force in their strikes than almost any other person on the planet. Striking strength is also a really broad category, and it in essence refers to any strength task related to striking. To put this in an example, Naruto is able to shatter rock with his punches and leave a crater in the ground. Now, depending on the density of this rock, let's say it's granite, which has an average density of 2.67 grams per cubic centimeter, which requires 19,000 pounds of pressure per every square inch. If granite broken, we can calculate the striking strength of Naruto, which would be somewhere about 19,000 pounds of force. So to put everything I've said together, striking strength refers to how powerful a single strike from a character can be, and lifting strength refers to the amount of weight a character can lift. These two things do not necessarily correlate to each other, as a guy who is good at bench pressing heavy weight and powerful punches. This also translates to attack potency, as the weight does not inherently make your attacks more powerful. This is generally an attack though, so you can usually say striking strength correlates to attack potency. The difference between striking strength and attack potency is that a character's attack potency does not inherently have to be reliant on their physical strikes, but possibly an ability they have, such as Superman's heat vision, which carries its own set of force and properties related to power, which is, of course, not related to his physical striking strength. Hope this guide allows you to better understand strength and clears up any misconceptions between the three terms. Anyway, now I've overstayed my welcome, so I'll go ahead and send it back to Servo.
Well, anyway, that's it for the video. I hope you all enjoyed it. A massive thanks to Noodles for coming onto the channel and helping me out with this video. If any of you are big fans of Naruto and power scaling in general, I implore you to go check out his
He been. Or we'll have to kill him. And his channel. And all that other shit. That nigga be lying now. He was spitting.
Look, I saw this nigga Ben 10 came clapping. He said, "You're wrong. Ben 10 ended up winning in the video." I'm like, "Andy?"
Yeah, nah.